So, welcome everybody to this hardcore session on Postgres, PostGIS. The first presenter is Felix Kunde, and he's an expert on PostGIS and also PostGIS lover and a teacher. And in the next 20 minutes, he'll teach us something about spatial indexes on the PostGIS. The stage is yours.
Thank you. So, my first question would be, because this is my first State of the Map conference, so I'm not super familiar with the audience. So, is there anybody in the room who has never really worked with PostGIS? Okay, so, and also, are there people in the room who have no clue what a spatial index is in a database? Because the talk will be all about that. And it's, yeah, it will be very technical. So, yeah, how to create spatial indexes in PostGIS. I already gave this talk at another conference. This time I also tried to do some experiments with OpenStreetMap data to see how it fits together. So I hope that most of you who have worked with PostGIS ever felt the need to create a spatial index in your database. Why you create a spatial index or index in general? It's because you want to make some query blazingly fast. Because without an index, probably it's quite slow if you have a lot of data. And this is the solution you usually find in tutorials and also in textbooks. It's just this command. You're using this table access method called gist, and it's there since forever. So it's, so to say, the default method. But I have given some PostGIS talks in the past and also introduced these different index types. And I asked myself also, like, there are these two other index types, BRIN index and SPGIS index. So SPGIS index only available for 1 year now. And yeah, I asked myself, okay, when shall I really use which index? Because I only use GIST so far, so let's do some experiments to find that out. And so to bring us all on the same level, I will first explain to you how every index is structured. So let's start with the GIST. And when I talk about the GIST, I refer to the GIST implementation of PostGIS, because GIST is actually a framework, so you can create different types of indexes on top of this GIST framework. It's mostly specifically designed for multidimensional data, so something that you cannot really sort by its nature, like ranges or also spatial data, so there you need some support like this. So, and this is also what the PostGIS developers did. They implemented an R-tree on top of this GIST framework. And how does an R-tree work? I will show you on the next slide. And what's also really good on the GIST index is that it supports multiple dimensions. So your geometries can also have three dimensions and also temporal information along with the geometry. And it also supports k-nearest neighbor queries, which is a very, like, so to say, common query in spatial databases. And so the basic idea of an R-tree is to not store the actual data in the index pages, because I mean, as OpenStreetMap users and developers, you probably know that there can be some very, very large polygons and line strings, etc. Then it's better to only put an approximation, like only the bounding box into the index pages. And this might now look like a very, very simplistic approach, but it's actually quite effective on spatial searches. And also for if you want to insert some data or update some data, it's easier if the algorithm only has to handle bounding boxes. And so let's just think of a very simple data set here. These are all the bounding boxes of all my spatial data. And it's all stored in the leaf pages of the index, which, so the leaves are then the pointers to the real location on the disk. And then what an R-tree does, it tries to group the areas which are like close to each other, put some bounding boxes around that, and it goes on until you have a root element. So when you do some searches then, you first see, okay, does my geometry fall into the left or the right red bounding box, and so on, and then you just start traversing the tree until you end up with some leaf node in the end. So yeah, it's quite a simple idea. It's very effective, but you also see the downside here is that yeah, you can have some overlaps in your index pages, so sometimes it can happen if your geometries fall into these overlapping areas that you do unnecessary searches in your index. So it's to go down to some leaf pages where the actual geometry is not there. So there is a nice tool for PostgreSQL available, designed by the developers of this GIST framework. It's called Gavel. And yeah, and it, you can use it to visualize the internal structure of your GIST index. So here I just generated like 10,000 points, and you can see my GIST index has two levels, and this is how the two levels do look like. And you also see that's quite nice. I don't have a lot of overlaps in my first level, which is very good. So, but you also see that usually these indexes in reality, or especially R-tree indexes, they are very wide. So they are not very deep. Even with 1 billion points, I end up only with like 4 levels. So this shows the reality there. And so here are some performance tests I did with artificially generated data. So I always added up 10 times more points just to see how things scale. And I found it quite a bit surprising that even without an index, my queries were reasonably fast with 1 million points. Only at 10 million points, I started like ending up with times like 600 milliseconds on my laptop. But yeah, after that, if your data doesn't fit into the RAM anymore, then of course things get way worse. You also, there's one recommendation when you create spatial indexes that you should run this vacuum analyze command so that your table statistics are up to date, so the database is more aware of what data is in your table. And so this can have an effect, as you see here. And another tip, which is often given, is that you can cluster your table based on the structure of an index, so that all the rows in your table are rewritten so that things that are close in the index are also then close on your hard drive. And you see, when I had a lot of data, this was really like a final booster then for me to make the queries way faster. Okay, so that's the GIST index. So now let's switch to the BRIN index. BRIN stands for Block Range Index, and this is a very, very simplistic idea because it only stores, so it divides your table into blocks and only stores the ranging values of each block. So, and therefore you might know, or you should be aware of then if it just goes down from top to bottom, just scans the table from top to bottom, and makes its division, and so your data needs to be sorted in some way. So if you have time series data, that's great, but yeah, if you have spatial data, you have to think about some management first. So this is how it would look like. It just goes from top to bottom, and yeah, for time series, it's quite clear. And for spatial data, it would store the bounding box of all the features which are in this area. And so now let's go back to this point example, for example, when I connect them with a line string. Oh, that's too far. So like 1,000 points, they're randomly generated, connect by a line, and you see that they are not sorted at all. So then BRIN index would not make any sense. So it would not be beneficial. So what you can do is in PostGIS, you can order your query result by the geometry column, which applies some so-called Morton curve. So it makes sure that things are really then in the result set, things that are close in reality are also close in your result set. And also, you can have the same effect with this STGeohash function. I don't know if you know this geohash concept. It just divides the Earth recursively into more and more cells, and each point in the end is accessible by one like geohash code. It's just numbers and letters, so to say. What will change in the next major version of PostGIS in version 3? It will not be Morton curve sorting, but it will be a Hilbert curve, which is probably more effective. Okay, so yeah, one thing I couldn't really figure out why, but I always had to trick the Postgres query planner to not use sequential scans. I always had to disable this feature so that the planner would prefer to use my index. I mean, if it's not avoidable to use sequential scan, of course, then it would still use sequential scan. And now here are some results again on artificial data. And what's the right column here is the most interesting one, because you can see this is the 1 billion point experiment, and you could see that when I use a GIST index, ideally it took 6 hours to build on my machine, but it could also take up 1 day or so on. And also the size is quite large, so I think my table, it was consisting of ID and points, it was like 60 gigabytes big. The table, the index then is also 50 gigabytes big. So it's quite large. The BRIN index, in comparison, was there after 90 seconds, and it was only like 3.5 megabytes big. So therefore, I would always recommend to you, just if you have a lot of data, just create a Brin index just to see if it works for you. And if it doesn't work for you, make sure that maybe you can cluster a table based on the geohash, or maybe you can just make a copy of your table with the ordering. So, and then create a Brin index on top of this. Of course, whenever you have, like for example, an OpenStreetMap database that you will update all the time, then of course Brin index is not useful because you have to make sure that the sorting is there. So, last but not least, final index, the SPGIST index. It's a quite new index, as you might guess by now. It's also a framework so provided by PostgreSQL, and you can create different kinds of indexes on top of this. And yeah, usually it works like this, that when there is a new index provided by the Postgres developers, still the PostGIS developers have to take care of it and have to implement something that works on the geometries of like the geometry type of Postgres, PostGIS, or the geography type as well. So now the special thing about the SPGIST index is the space partitioning. That's what the SP stands for. And the idea is that you start you recursively split your data set where you have more data. So this picture shows it. So those areas which have more dense area, more dense data, you have a deeper nesting in the index. You have more levels than in your index. Of course, then this is a bit unbalanced then, but still, it's from an algorithmic standpoint, it's a quite effective tree. So you also know them, for example, by KD trees or quad trees. And so they are really efficient for in-memory things. So a bit hard to do them on disk, but for example, in web mapping, if you want to calculate the tiles which are visible to the camera, most often these kind of indexes are used there. And so one important thing about the space partitioning here is that no data overlaps are allowed in this index. And now you might wonder, okay, how can we store then bounding boxes in there? Because bounding boxes are overlapping. And so the trick here is to just put everything into points, to just project all the information you have of a bounding box into a multidimensional point and retrieve all the data from there. So then you can guarantee that there are no overlaps. And this makes this index also more efficient maybe for if you have data which has a lot of overlaps. So if you have polygon data sets, line data sets that have a lot of overlap, this index can be more effective than the GIST index. And so the good thing, if you have this clear partitioning, it's also easier to tell where to find the data and where new data shall go in which cell. And so from an algorithmic standpoint, it's a bit easier. So I will skip this prefix splitting part because it's harder to understand. I also tried to visualize it with this Gevel tool, but unfortunately this doesn't really work that nicely with the PostGIS SPGIST index. So you could still print some statistics and so on. And then generally I could say in my test that I did with artificial data, but also with PostGIS, with OS OpenStreetMap data, that most of the times GIST is faster, but SPGIST builds a bit faster and is a bit smaller. So now let's get to thematic filtering. That's like another group because maybe you do not only, if you want to analyze OpenStreetMap data, you're not only interested in like spatial, purely spatial queries, but also you have some thematic filtering in mind. So you want to filter all the trees or all the buildings and so on. So now you might want ask yourself, okay, can I combine two columns in one index? And yes, you can create a multi-column index. It requires you to add this B-tree GIST extension to your database, but then you can do it. You can also add more columns there, so it's not only limited to two. And if you wonder which column shall go first, usually the one which is more selective. And so in my case, I only did some analysis on the Germany data set. So there, the spatial filtering was, of course, more selective than any other thematic filtering. And of course, if you put more columns in your index, then your index gets bigger. But of course, then you also need less read from the real data disk. And so what I usually recommend, if you're only interested in a certain theme and if you're using a tool like OSM2PGSQL, where all this stuff gets end up in just like one table, one point table, line table, and polygon table. So then you should maybe go for these partial indexes. So in on these index definitions, you can also add a where clause to say, okay, I want to create an index only on all the power poles, for example. And then the in only the rows in these, only the rows that you have specified here are then in the index. So this makes your index a lot smaller. And also, when you have a lot of writes, this doesn't affect these writes that much if you have just a compared to one huge index. And I also see that some in the OSM wiki, I could see some recommendations of people that are using this. Of course, you also have to keep in mind that this is a quite specific index. So make sure, maybe you need to create more partial indexes. Don't overdo it. Don't just go there and just create partial indexes for everything you can imagine, because having too many indexes will also not be very, very good for your database. So always keep in mind what are the most urgent queries that you want to have it, have them fast. So and then create partial indexes for them. Or maybe you just use other OpenStreetMap importer tools. Covering indexes, that it's a quite new thing. I might skip that because it will only be available in Postgres 12. And yeah, I will also skip the other things. Now let's go to OSM experiments I did. So I choose first three different data sets to see how the index size ranges and like how big the geometry part is in the table. This was just to see the scaling, and I continued my experience mostly on the Germany data set because this was like big enough for some real numbers. So here you can also see some funny pictures I did. Like I created a gist index for Germany for this is for the points. Also did that for the lines and also for the polygons. So you can look them up after the talk. And this is done with dBeaver, by the way. If you want to use a good database client, use dBeaver because now it also has a spatial viewer, which is pretty nice. And so here are some results. I just did 10,000 runs with random points, and I always did an intersection query against these three tables, and you can see that with the points, there was a big difference. So the blue line is the Brin index, so it was a lot slower. I mean, like 30 milliseconds, but compared to like, I don't know, 2-5 milliseconds from the other indexes. But for the polygons, you can see that the polygons was like 35 million polygons compared to 15 million points, so way more data. And you could see that when you have more and more data, the gap gets closer. So Brin is still the slowest, but it's not that far away again from the others. And also you could see here that for polygons, SPGIST index turned out to be a bit more, in total it was faster than the GIST index. Yeah, I also tried to do some specific experiments for the SPGIST index. Unbalanced data sets and indexed them to see if SPGIST index is really faster for such kind of unbalanced data sets. But yeah, it was a bit faster for points and polygons, I could say. But I also saw in some plans that the is it visible from here? So the down, the second red box, this is the shared hit rate from the SPGIST index, which was a lot higher. So could be that for bigger data sets that this will be a downside then for the SPGIST index. Okay, so let's get to the conclusion. What can I recommend to you? So probably you can stick with GIST because it has the KNN support, which the Brin index lacks, and the SPGIST index might get it with the next Postgres version, but it's not there yet. So if you really need KNN queries and also good geography support, then go with GIST. But always, if you have huge data sets, give Brin a try, just because it's a no-brainer. It's creation time is so short and the size is so small, so then just give it a try, see if it works. Use partial indexes, because they are just way more efficient than these large indexes. And if you feel you have maybe unbalanced data or maybe also spatial temporal data, so I learned that for spatial temporal data, SPGIST can be also a quite good fit. And always keep your table statistics up to date, because this is also a very common problem. So like at Zalando, this is one of the most things that we often tell our customers, and when they have a slow query, we always tell them, yeah, run Recum Analyze, and then we talk again, and then they were never seen again. So, So, and then this is just the last slide, an outlook. So what will the future bring us? So the next major version of PostGIS will have some improvements, especially for parallel queries. So the new Postgres, so the Postgres developers, they created some nice new, cool new interface so that the query planner of PostgreSQL will more favor to do parallel stuff with these spatial functions, which is quite cool. And also there is a patch out there, which, yeah, like yesterday I talked to Dara Fai, he was here, he's one of the committers of PostGIS, and he wants everybody to push this idea a bit more forward, because this patch will, can make your queries and the index building time for GIST indexes like on orders of magnitudes faster. So this would also be a huge win. So it, I think it uses also this Hilbert curve sorting, so this is a, has a huge performance impact. Yeah, and I think the rest too I will leave out for now. And yeah, I'm happy to take up questions, because I will leave just like just after this talk. So if you have questions, ask them now, so I, because I will not be around.
Thank you, Felix, for your interesting talk. Questions? Here. Microphone.
I can also repeat, so.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, use the micro.
Thanks. You mentioned that on SQGIST, you're reducing a polygon feature to a point.
Yeah.
But when you do your queries, are you assuming that all the polygons pretty much have a uniform size distribution? Or what happens in a case when you have a building, a small feature, and a forest in a very large building, and I want to do a query for a bounding box and see which of the features intersect? How can you do that if you reduce it to a point?
Yeah, it's not that it's only a point. Like, all the information is still there, but you have internally, you just have a point with like lots of dimensions. So you just squash everything into a point, but all the informations are still there to do all this spatial calculation of overlapping. So
but how
it's a bit mind-bending, but so yeah, also hard to understand for me, but this is the trick to do
but
it,
if,
yeah.
But if your forest is 500 kilo or 50 kilometers across, and I have a bounding box that catches the northwesternmost corner, and how does it interrelate it? Because the point, if you're using a centroid, will be, you know, 25 kilometers away, so.
Yeah, that's a good question. Unfortunately, I couldn't really visualize it with this gavel tool. That would be cool if, yeah, in this case, I would ask myself also, like, where will it end up, in which cell, and, but, yeah. I think maybe probably it's with it could be with the prefixes or so on that, with the prefixes that you get to the real estimation of the polygon, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, I had a question. You mentioned that you disabled sequential scan. Was that just for one of the tests that you ran, and that was just the problem with that, or?
Yeah, actually, I disabled it for all my tests.
Too. Okay, just to see how it works.
And yeah.
if there are only, too like, many more questions, I actually was curious to hear about the new table access methods, if there's time for that later.
Yeah.
How would you expect SPGIS to perform in the case where you've got a database that's being updated continually with minutely, and how long does its performance degrade faster or slower than the traditional GIST index?
Yeah, this I haven't really tested. I also found that, or maybe I can go to this one slide where there's the comparison. So one thing that I found is that at some point, for example, the creation time, also sometimes the it really depends on your data. So sometimes the execution times for like creating the index and also for querying can all of a sudden be a lot slower for some reason. So if I have a test row with different tests, and there was like one or two tests which like spiked out, so yeah, maybe it still has to major more, probably. But I think for insertions generally, but theoretically, it should be easier to handle these updates, I think.
In case there are additional questions, please ask Felix, probably before he leaves to the train.
I just wanted to mention one more thing, which I haven't forgot in my talk, because now that you ask about, is when you use a tool like OSM2PGSQL, it does a table clustering. So you can already use the immediately use the Brin index, which was really nice. I was quite surprised by this when I started my test. Yeah. Okay. So that was just the information I wanted to say. Okay.
Thank you, Felix, again for your interesting insights.
See you around. Thanks for having me.